Now then, a rally in Gaza to mark the 10th anniversary of the death of the Palestinian leader Yasser Arafat has been cancelled because of security concerns. The last 6 months have seen increased tension, of course, between Israel and the Palestinians. More than 2,000 people died during rocket attacks and ground fighting in Gaza in July and August. And 4 people have died in attacks in Tel Aviv and the West Bank since yesterday morning. Well, I'm joined now from Jerusalem by Dr. Einat Wiltz, Senior Fellow at the Jewish People's Policy Institute, and Professor Garda Karmi, Research Fellow at the Institute of Arab and Islamic Studies at the University of Exeter, joins me from central London. And a very good morning to you both. If I could start with the same question, and starting with you, Dr. Wiltz, do you feel that there's any chance of a breakthrough in the peace process, given the poisoned atmosphere that exists after the conflict of the summer?
The ability for a breakthrough depends very little on current events or momentary details. The possibility of breakthrough depends on the bigger question: what is the conflict about? And sadly, it still appears that the conflict remains about the denial, sometimes intellectual, sometimes violent, of the right of the Jewish people to a sovereign state in their homeland. A full and absolute and complete acceptance of this right does not exist right now, barely among the Arab world, certainly not among the Palestinians. Everything else is details. At the basis, there's no acceptance that the Jewish people have this right, that they have a right to a sovereign state. We have just heard the Iranian leader speak of a 9-point plan for the elimination of the Jewish state. We know that today in the Middle East, the Jewish people are a tiny and, shall we say, very unwelcome minority, certainly one that cannot be accepted as equal, one that is considered to have the right of self-determination in its ancient homeland. Okay. We see a complete denial of the historical right of the Jewish people, the connection to the Temple Mount, to the land of Israel. Without full recognition of that right, okay, I doubt that we could have true peace.
I want to get Professor Karmi's response to that. The analysis there from Dr. Wiltz, that underlying all this, the key to progress is the understanding, the acceptance that the Jewish people have a right to a state. It has a right to exist.
I'm afraid that's very misleading. The version you've got there is the official Israeli version, and I'm afraid it's erroneous. The conflict is not about the right of the Jewish people to a homeland. It's not to do nothing to do with that. As a matter of fact, the Palestinians have recognized Israel repeatedly. No, no. The conflict is about the fact that Israel has taken the land of the Palestinians. It is still doing it. Israel is in illegal occupation of the 1967 territories, including East Jerusalem. So it's really not right to put this forward as something else. This is what it is. Now, as for the right of Israel to exist, I don't think states normally demand the right to exist. They're normally recognized. That's what happens in diplomatic discourse. This is a red herring. The reality
is... Well, is it, Professor Karmi? I mean, the point being made by Dr. Wiltz is that, and you say that, you know, Israel exists, but Hamas, who run Gaza, have said that they want to destroy Israel, so they live in a state of perpetual fear.
No, 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 no. Hamas is a small movement. Let's get this straight. It's been demonized. It's a small movement. It's got about 10 to 15,000 fighters. That is as nothing to the Israeli army. This is quite an absurd claim. And Hamas does not deny the existence of Israel. On the contrary, it has repeatedly said that it recognizes Israel in terms of, or for the purpose of, a peace agreement. I think people need to read more carefully what Hamas says and not listen to the Israeli propaganda. Now, the fact is that at the moment there is tremendous unrest, as your introduction pointed out. And why is that? Because Israel, which is already in illegal occupation of Jerusalem, is now trying to protect its religious zealots, Jewish religious zealots, from getting onto the Haram al-Sharif and trying to get inside the Aqsa Mosque. Yeah. Can you imagine anything more provocative? Well, the Aqsa Mosque is the third holiest shrine in Islam.
All right.
It's not for Jews, it's for Muslims. Christians
go in. Let's make this a conversation, which, of course, it has to be, and Dr. Wilf, come back on some of those points. And just let me put this to you, you know, as seen from the outside world, this, it seems, most intractable of conflicts. What it requires, and Israel is the most powerful you will accept in this equation, what it seems to require is an act of good faith. Israel removing some of its settlements from the West Bank, ending the stranglehold on Gaza. Could progress not be made in that direction?
Israel has repeatedly shown goodwill for a very long time, including numerous offers to make peace agreements, to partition and to share the land between a Jewish state and an Arab state. But sadly, many of the Palestinian speakers have grown very good at obfuscating the real issue. They say they recognize Israel. Recognizing a reality is not much of an achievement. The battle, the conflict, is around the right of the Jewish people to sovereignty in their historical homeland. We're seeing a denial of the historical connection between the Jewish people and the Temple Mount, between the Jewish people and the land of Israel. The Jewish people have not taken a foreign land. It is their own. They are not foreigners in their own homeland. Yes, the Arab Palestinians lay claim to that land too, but their right is not exclusive, and the Jewish people have very much a right, very much an equal right to be there. And we are a minority in the Middle East. We might be powerful as a state, but if you look around the region, certainly given what's happening right now, there it is a region that is turning genocidal towards minorities. There is increasingly no room for Christians in the Middle East. It is clear that if Israel did not have the means to defend itself, there would be no room for Jews in the Middle East. They were thrown out of Arab countries a few decades ago. So this is what the conflict is about. Recognizing Israel's existence is really not much.
All right, you're getting back to that point. And Professor Karmi, I mean, unequivocally, and given the point you've made earlier about some of the occupied territories, do you accept, though, that the Israelis, the Jewish people in that part of the world have a right to some of the land there?
Look, the Jewish people, or rather the Israeli people, are already there. It would be very foolish for me.
But do they have a right to it? Do they have a right to stay there?
Look, they have, everybody has a right if they behave properly. The problem with Israel is it is very aggressive. It's killed 2,000 people in Gaza. And in the last few days, it's killed a young Palestinian who is actually running away. You know that Israel behaves in a way which is not acceptable. And most of the world populations, not their governments, populations, have shown that clearly during the war in Gaza. They've been out demonstrating. If Israel behaves itself and learns to be a member of the civilized community of nations, then it will have rights to whatever it pleases. But so long as it persecutes people, imprisons them in Gaza, as you pointed out, and kills them at will without any accountability, any comeback, of course it has no rights. Just as a criminal who kills and murders people doesn't have rights. It's in that sense that it has no right.
Okay, so Dr. Wilf, the point being made there, and it's often made, and particularly during the course of those conflicts against Gaza, the actions taken against Gaza, that there's a disproportionate response by some measure from Israel.
Well, I'm happy to hear that our right is conditioned upon our behavior to be determined by other people. The Jewish people are determined to no longer have conditional right to sovereignty. It is our right by our history, by our connection to the land. It is conditioned on nothing. We have earned it through our history, through our connection to the land, and it is not conditioned on behavior. If states were allowed to exist based on their behavior, I have some excellent candidates for countries that should not exist, and Israel is certainly not among the top. Israel is a country that has acted with the greatest caution and prudence against overwhelming odds. Again, we are 6 million Jews among nearly 400 million Muslim Arabs, 1.2 billion Muslims around the world who do not accept our right to exist as a sovereign people, do not accept our connection. So we are merely protecting ourselves and protecting our right to sovereignty in our homeland.
Well, great to talk to you both. Thank you very much indeed. Dr. Anna Wilf there from the Jewish People's Policy Institute and Professor Garda Karmi there from the University of Essex.